even know me. So I have a mission for you. You are to give them an impression of who I am. Only then the king got up to leave. And as he left, the king, the young man was frightened, was speechless. He finally found his voice as the king moved towards the door. He said, "But I don't even know you." The king went right on. He said, "What am I supposed to do?" King went right on out the door. Finally, the man said, "Why did you choose me to do this?" Next thing he knew, the guards were there. He was escorted out of the palace, outside he was. He went home, told his parents. They were overjoyed, of course. They called in the family, the friends. They called everybody together. They had a great feast. "My son, special to the king." But the young man went about his labors, feeding the pigs and fertilizing the fields and doing his daily chores, all the time wondering, "What in the world is this all about?" So finally he found the courage to go to the wise man in the village and shared with him his concerns. And the wise man said to him, he said, "You told the king, 'I do not even know you.' But think now. Think back about how the king treated you. Think about how he embraced you and rejoiced over you. Doesn't that tell you something about who the king is?" And you ask the question, "What am I to do?" You're a farmer. Farm. It doesn't do any good for a farmer to be a banker. It doesn't do any good for a banker to be a chemist. You're a farmer. Farm. And you ask, "Why is it that the king chose me?" And the wise man said, "The answer is, he could have chosen somebody else." And so the young man left. And as he went about his life, there was a joy, a peace about him. Came to be in his presence. There was something that he saw, something that he had, something that he felt that people wanted. And when he died, his family went through all his belongings, searching for what the key to his joy might be. Hoping to avoid any effort to squash the story or to get it, let me just make a few comments. First of all, there's the king's call. Think about the prophet Jeremiah. "In my mother's womb, the Lord fashioned me." Think about Paul. "I was formed in my mother's womb, and by God's grace was given to know his son." We have been called, every single one of you. Pretend we have. We can think that, you know, that's just nice jargon, it's a nice talk. But the fact is that each one of us, before we have been born, we have been called. The Lord could have made this world without you. He could. Except he couldn't have. He couldn't imagine this world without you. He couldn't imagine this world without each one of us. The mission. Give them an impression of who I am. We gather tonight as ministers, and I think, I'm going to say this, I think the best ministers are those ministers that aren't even noticed. They aren't even seen. But I think too often ministry makes people look at the minister, "Well, the minister should disappear." What does John say? You know, "I have to decrease. The Lord has to increase." As ministers, we have to be transparent. Not transparent very well, transparent. are seeing Christ. They may not even say thank you. They may not even recognize what we've done, except they've been touched by the Lord. That's ministry. That's ministry. We have disappeared. It's strange. Example, I think the priest presides in the Eucharist most effectively when no one comments about how he presides. You know what I'm trying to say? That when they don't even, the presiding is lost. Christ is seen. That's ministry. That's what ministry is. There are these three questions that the young man asked. I don't even know you, he says to the king. You know, that's why Jesus gives us Eucharist. He wants us to know him. He wants us to know even as he knows us. He gives us Eucharist as food for the journey because he wants us to enter him, to be assimilated into him, and to be the people who do his innovations in the world, who touch his gospel to the part of the world in which he sends us. And then he asks the question, well, what am I to do? And I think what we are to do is to keep our eye on Jesus. And he'll tell us what to do. Keep our eye on Jesus. The gospel that we're reflecting on tonight, you know that? The gospel we heard was last weekend, the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. It's interesting, isn't it, that the disciples knew how much they had. You know, they counted it. And that's the way it is so often, I think, in my life, Richard. I know what it is that I have. I think it belongs to me. So I keep good inventory. I keep good count. 5 loaves and 2 fish. And what scares me, and I think what Eucharist challenges of me and all of us to be about, is to realize that more often than not, I don't want, if I were there when Jesus asked, was aware of it, but probably needed it, I'm not sure I would have told him I had 5 loaves and 2 fish. I think I would have kept it to myself. You know? I'm not sure I would have let go of it. You know what I'm saying? I think I would be to myself, God, you know, so little it can't do much good, so I'm not even going to bother Jesus with this. Or even a better registration, I would say to myself, John, you need to eat so that you can be strong enough to do God's will. So you feed yourself and then you'll be able to do this. Or, you know, or I just think, you know, well, Jesus, you're number one. You take care of it. That's your thing. It's not my thing. 5 loaves and 2 fish. What does Jesus ask? What do we do? Just giving what we got. Giving the little we got. And Jesus says, watch what I do. Watch what I do for your sake and the sake. That last question, of course, the young man asked, well, why did you choose me? Why am I the one who has to do it? And the answer is, of course, Jesus didn't have to choose us. But he did. What matters is that God calls. What matters is that God calls. And that's, if you will, the majesty and the mystery and the magic of the universe. Is that God calls us, and so now we know that he's not going to give up on us until he comes to full stature in us, if we'll allow it, if we'll stay with him. Jesus is going to have his way with us. And his way is that he's going to come to full stature in us, and we're going to be able to give to the world and answer the question. What difference does it make? Bread and wine are transformed into the body and blood of Christ. And we are not. We are overwhelmed. What answer we give to that question? So thank you again, very, very much for the invitation.